I'm Jose Cardenas. Thank you for joining us. Governor Jan Brewer outlined her vision for Arizona in her State of the State address before the joint session of the 51st Arizona State Legislature this week. The governor said she will spend her political capital this session fighting for children and the poor. She repeatedly said Arizona's future hinges on its ability to compete in education and economically. Here to talk about the speech and the challenges state lawmakers face this legislative session is Bettina Nava, partner with FirstStrategic, a communication and public affairs firm. Nava worked as one of 11 regional campaign managers for the McCain 2008 presidential team across the country. Also here is John Loredo of Loredo & Associates. He's a Democratic political consultant and former state lawmaker. Thank you both for joining us on Horizonte to talk about the governor's State of the State speech. There were a few surprises, and I think two of them, for different reasons, would be her comments about Medicaid, the expansion of Medicaid, and what she had to say about immigration. So your take on that, on Medicaid first.
Well, I think what we saw with the governor is that she's really showing leadership. She is in her second term. She's really thinking about legacy, which is what you tend to do in another term. And really, she's very laser-focused about what she wants to accomplish. I mean, everything that they're talking about, there is nothing frivolous that they're talking about. But she's shown that she can be very, very laser-focused. And I was, for one, surprised by the Medicaid expansion and pleasantly surprised by it.
Well, and she introduced it rather cleverly, I thought, when she said, you can't wave your finger at the federal government. I know I've tried that. She said, trust me. A reference to her,
encounter. She's funny.
Yeah, her encounter with the president. But it did seem to be a change, at least in what you would have expected her to do on this issue. It's certainly not something her Republican colleagues are likely to support.
Yeah, and I think that's why I was a little, I mean, clearly, John, he's going to tell you, I think he knew about it, so he clearly has a better inside track than I do. But it's going to be an uphill battle with her Republican colleagues, and therefore, you know, definitely you only have so many political favors and priorities that you can call in. So I was surprised.
John, you and the governor talk about these issues frequently. Is that how you know?
I helped her out a little bit.
But overall, it was a surprise, don't you think, at least, and not what people would have been expecting?
Well, I think if you follow the whole access issue, there's kind of a timeline that we're operating on here. And when the state of Arizona got word back that the federal government was not going to continue the match if we covered 100% of the federal poverty level, it put Arizona in the position and Governor Brewer in the position of trying to figure out how to fund it, basically. And without the federal match at 100% of the federal poverty level, it was going to cost the state a huge amount of money in order to fund it by ourselves. Because of, you know, the federal government came back and said, look, if you fund 133% of it, we will pay the overwhelming majority of the cost, and you will actually have to pay a lot less than you would just to fund 100%. So it just made mathematical sense to spend a smaller amount of money to cover a lot more people than the other way around. And if you're in the position to do that, we need to take advantage of that and do that, because there are certainly a lot of people in Arizona who used to be on access, but because of budget cuts and everything else, are no longer on access, but they still need health care. These are the working poor. These are people too poor to afford health insurance. It is in everyone's best interest that people stay healthy.
Well, and speaking of everyone's best interest, she was receiving a lot of input from the healthcare industry about the financial devastation, really, in their business that would occur if she didn't do this, and the big boost if she did. All that said, do you expect her to be able to convince her colleagues in the Republican-dominated legislature that that's the thing to do?
You know, there are a lot of people who have absolutely no tolerance or acceptance of Obamacare whatsoever. And so I think some people confuse the issues as one and the same, and they're not. And so I think there are enough people within the Republican caucus who understand that even though you may not want to do this, even though you may not like it, we've got to do something. I mean, doing nothing is simply not a realistic option. And so from Governor Brewer's point of view, she's going to have to do something that she has not done before, and that's be willing to work with the bipartisan coalition of votes. We've had, you know, every governor before her at some point or another has had to put a coalition of votes together in order to get something done on something big. You have to be more dedicated to the issue than you are to the politics in order to make that happen. And in this case, I think for her to go out and, you know, kind of on a limb and say, we need to do this and it's a priority, whether anybody likes it or not, I think is a good sign because the votes are certainly going to be there when she needs them. It's just a matter of who the votes come from and what the negotiations are back and forth. But it's one of those issues that you have to get done no matter what.
Now, Bettina, another area of departure possibly from her Republican colleagues are her comments on immigration. She didn't say anything specific about what she would do, but did at least the tone of her comments seemed to be different.
I think we can all admit there's been a dramatic shift since the election. I think the writing's on the wall. And I think a lot of candidates came to the realization that if we don't tone down, the Republican Party doesn't tone down the rhetoric and the hyperbole and really sit down and talk about a comprehensive approach, that the party will become the party of the Whigs. It'll be non-existent. And that was one of the many outcomes from the 2012 elections.
Well, and her message was, to the federal government, you secure the border,
correct,
and then I will engage fully on comprehensive immigration reform. Do you expect anything concrete to come out of that?
I do, only because I really do think that, Obama's going to have to keep good to his promise. He wasn't able to accomplish it in his first term. Second term president, it's time for him. He said that it's a priority. So it's really going to be driven by the federal government, per se. It's still a federal issue. But I think for the first time, states are now going to come to the table and really provide some, real avenues to get something done, because it's long overdue. Everyone's exhausted by the issue. It's not getting any easier. And if you put the politics aside, you might actually come out ahead.
John, do you expect to see anything in this legislative session that deals in an affirmative way with immigration?
I don't expect to. I mean, there are a lot of people that they would hope that they would deal with the driver's license issue for the Dream Act students who are here under the deferred program. But I think that looking at last year as kind of an indication of the mood, a lot of these bills just didn't go anywhere. You know, they made it through maybe a committee or two, and then they just died.
These are the anti-immigration
bills. And there simply is not a lot of appetite there. And honestly, the opposition now is finally being pushed by the business community that is simply saying, we can't sustain another boycott. We can't afford to look bad. We need to improve our image, not make, take a step backwards. So I think they've got enough people listening to them now that makes it very difficult. And with Russell Pierce gone, that type of hateful rhetoric just simply isn't heard as much as it used to be.
Now, there were a couple of other areas of particular significance in this speech. One was her comments on Child Protective Services. She says she wants 150 new people there for that department, and then she wants an additional 50 right away. What do you see coming of that?
Well, again, I think there would absolutely be enough votes to get those bills out if you approach it in a bipartisan manner. You could get it done very quickly. Whether or not she chooses to do that, who knows? But there are going to be people within the Republican caucus who are probably more receptive to that than they are for other things that she mentioned, such as access. So I would expect them to go ahead and move forward on that. What will bog it down is if people start trying to attach conditions on it. They start trying to attach various, the experimental ideas to do with CPS and this and that. And it becomes what's referred to as a Christmas tree. Everybody starts hanging ornaments on it till it gets so heavy that it just falls down. But I think if they're serious about protecting kids, they can get a funding bill out pretty quickly.
And Bettina, speaking of funding, the governor also emphasized that she's going to put money into education. In fact, she talked about having the nation's first comprehensive performance funding package. Where's all the money going to come from?
Well, that's the interesting part. I mean, I think she was very clear in her state of the state. She has three really focused areas: K-12 funding, Medicaid expansion, and CPS. And I think right now we're in decent shape to make those things happen. The interesting question is, what do you do starting next year? Because really right now we have the funds to get things done. We have a rainy day fund, so to speak. But what happens in 2014, 15, and 16? are those spending elements, are they sustainable?
And that's the real question. And that's when we'll start feeling the effects of the expiration of the sales tax.
Correct. So that's the real question. It's sustainable now, but is it sustainable by 2016 when we're expected to once again have a $1 billion deficit and be right up at that cliff again?
John, the only thing she said about revenues that I can recall is, one, she pointed out that the one-cent sales tax was going away. And then she talked about reforming our state sales tax. She didn't say in what fashion, but certainly no suggestion that we're going to raise taxes or come up with some other sources of revenue. Where's the money going to come from?
Well, the dangerous part of reforming the sales tax is always that reform can mean anything to anybody. And for the folks pushing this hard, it typically means some type of a tax cut. And that means even less money to pay for things like school books and everything else that are a priority. So you do have that cliff that's coming next year, and it's not just the expiration of the sales tax. It is a massive corporate tax bill that kicks in full steam next year that just sends us right over the edge in terms of having any money to do anything. And so they do have to figure out another way. Governor Brewer and the Republicans at the legislature have not uttered one word about any new revenues coming in. So they're going to, you know, they're going to have to pull a rabbit out of a hat to avoid massive cuts next year, and I think everybody's waiting to see what their plan to do that is. And certainly that is something to take into consideration when they're funding these programs now. But hopefully the economy will continue to improve, and as it does, revenues will pick up, but not enough to match the fiscal cliff that's happening next year.
But here's something really, really interesting. She took the healthcare exchange off the table. Thus, she didn't tinker with the general fund. Does that mean that the governor is going in the direction of really trying to leave the legacy of essentially fixing the Arizona tax code, which is one of the most confusing? I have no idea every year. It's one of the most confusing in the country. I really wonder if that's going to be one of her next legacy pieces.
Well, that's how she described what she wanted to do with the sales tax, which was to simplify it. A couple of other things real quick because we're almost out of time. Guns is obviously a topic of great discussion in the country these days. Her only comment was that she would provide funding for training school resource officers. Do you expect anything else?
I think that's the one thing that people should be able to agree on. After Columbine, I was in the legislature when Columbine happened, and the response was to increase funding for school resource officers dramatically. That funding has since been drastically cut. So they need to restore that funding, and they need to bring it back up to where, not only where it was, but even more now. And so I would hope that would be the one thing that they would pass as a separate issue, not bundle everything together, because nothing will pass. But that is the one thing that they can do. In terms of universal background checks, everything else, you know, you also have to look and see what the feds are going to do as well. But certainly closing the gun show loophole is another option that they should be looking at.
Bettina, we're almost out of time. Just one last kind of summary question. How would you assess the governor's performance on this State of the State presentation?
You know, I thought she showed real leadership and real compassion, and she has definitely moved into legacy mode, and it was incredibly, incredibly bold. So I really foresee a lot of bipartisan efforts, whether it's on gun control, I really do, or a protocol for school safety. I really do see that coming down, whether it's immigration, leadership really kind of shunning bills that are problematic and that have been a black eye on Arizona in the past. So I see a real bipartisan movement ahead of us. Maybe I'm too optimistic, but I see it.
We'll know soon enough. In the meantime, thank you both for joining us on Odyssey.